Oh my word.
Well, will you give me the honor?
Changed it.
Yeah. Will you consent to sit with me?
Well, I'd be honored. Where's the sign-in sheet?
Right there. Yes, yeah, right.
The usual, but I think so.
Morning.
The sign-in is right there. I don't know what that is. I don't get it. Yeah, they're back there too.
Yeah, I just froze the projector to take a look at the slides.
Okay.
Now we can see. That's fine. Thanks.
One reason I asked that lady where she was from, I had thought that we had lost our local chapter.
Well, yes and no. We became part of a larger chapter.
It was Denver chapter.
Well, they called it the Great American chapter because it was some states that were connected together. But we have our own division, so we still have a local,
still have an office.
We still have a local office and a division. Yes. But yeah, we don't have a self-governing chapter.
So we don't have a committee that oversees
the local chapter. It's just an advisory committee. It doesn't have any power. And it actually has worked out better because Arkansas could not afford, you know, the board was constantly trying to find ways to pay the local staff. And so now the local staff is paid by the national organization. And so it actually worked out better.
Dr. Archer got an award from the Multiple Sclerosis Society. The lady who gave it. So impressed with him, I wasn't sure she was going to be able to get it all out.
Well, she had been pregnant recently, and I think she's a little more emotional.
That was another reason I thought maybe if I asked her a question, it would divert her from.
I thought that was a good move, and it did help.
A little bit.
She was able to focus a little bit on something else, and so I appreciated that.
So was this a giant award with money?
No, what it was, they called a Partners in Care Award, which, so they have criteria for MS clinics that they will put on their website and say, these are the people you need to go see, these are your first class MS clinics. So we get to be listed in the first class MS clinics. And of course, first thing my wife said was, because we can receive more patients.
All you need is some more business. No.
Well, I can't remember that came up in the video. As good as you said, we were really not actually.
But if we get all these people in that we're recruiting, then they're going to need them.
Oh, that would help. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. It's made the secret. It's carrying
Yes, well, that's not a secret. So she's I guess, probably 90% committed.
That's very good.
Yeah, that'll help us. And yeah. We had this Sarah Qureshi that came for our rounds. I think we've got a 50-50 chance for her.
Do we know with whom we're competing?
Kentucky.
Well, that's one of them.
Well, yeah. I think that may be the big one, just because they've offered her more money. She talked about preventing PML by changing the dosing regimen for Tysabri.
I didn't figure out how to change it. I thought your point was pretty big. The number of patients they have, if they get one more than a second week, the patient would be expanded into the total population of patients. So it's going to be hard to use that. I think you brought that up. Are you looking for the sign in?
No, I'm just looking for the option from the residents to sign in.
The sign in's in the back.
Yes.
Yeah. I'll make a sign in also. Still not starting.
As I'm sure you know, probably the people in our department. Well, they did it here yesterday and earlier this morning. It's been doing over. As I remember, 15 years ago, a tumor that we called something else, they decided it was primary CNS lymphoma. It had a different name. Do you know the history? You know, we didn't always call this a lymphoma, this tumor. Or did
they
you
call it something? I'm not sure.
Probably many years ago that the name was changed to primary CNS lymphoma.
Good morning, everyone. I think I know most people, but for those who don't know me, I'm Carlos Romo, one of the PGY2 residents here in the neurology department. And I'm glad to be here and talk about what I think is an interesting topic for Grand Rounds. So I appreciate the opportunity. So we're going to be talking about primary CNS lymphoma, okay? And first off, I wanted to talk about what a primary CNS neoplasm or cancer means. And it means that if it's a cancer or a tumor that's exclusive or initiated in the brain or the CNS, okay? And so there's multiple difference of these types of cancers, but for the one we're gonna talk about, which is primary CNS lymphoma, the definition is that this is a very uncommon, we'll talk a little bit about the incidence, but it's a very uncommon type of cancer. And it's a form of extranodal lymphoma, meaning that it's not in the lymph nodes where it usually occurs, but outside of the lymph nodes. And it can involve the brain, meninges, the eyes, like I said, anywhere in the central nervous system. And we're going to talk about the distribution of where it's usually located later today. Okay? So when we see the types of cancers that affect the central nervous system, this is a study by the CB Trust, and that they collect all the samples, the tissue samples. And by histology, they analyzed a very big population of patients. This is 300,000 patients, over 300,000 patients, and they distributed the types of cancers by histology. And we can see here that lymphoma accounts for about 2.1% of all those cancers, okay? Meningiomas being the most common ones. And this is just any type of masses by histology. If we talk specifically about malignancies, then we see that lymphoma is about 6.2%. Depending on the literature you read, it says anywhere from 4 to 6.2%. The most common one, of course, being glioblastomas and other astrocytomas, and the rest are delineated there. But we're going to focus today on just lymphoma. And again, this is lymphoma that arises in the nervous system, not that metastasized to the nervous system. Okay? So the big picture, we're going to focus on this. And I wanted to show this image just to remind everyone what we're going to talk about. So this is a multipotential hematopoietic cell at the beginning of the top, and this is where all the cells that make up our blood form. And we're going to concentrate on this one right here, the B lymphocyte, because we're going to see that lymphoma on the brain is most of the times type of B lymphocyte cancer. Okay, you can have any other of the other cells, T lymphocytes, and any of the other cells, but mostly it's the B lymphocytes, okay? And the classification of lymphoma, so we have the classical Hodgkin's lymphoma, we know that it has the Reed-Sternberg cells, and we have the non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, which is the more common type of lymphoma we see both in the CNS and also systemically, okay? And the most common form of systemic lymphoma is a diffuse large B-cell lymphoma, which is also the most common form in central nervous system lymphoma. So it's both, in both cases, the most common type of histology we'll see, and even though it's only 31%, that's the most common. The rest are the different ones that are mentioned there. So the incidence of primary CNS lymphoma is about 4 cases per million persons. That's a little bit, that's very similar to what Sabine was talking about the other day for NMO. So it's very rare. But it's still, I think we see a lot more NMO here, and the oncologists see a little bit more of the lymphoma, of course, but it's about the same incidence. And we saw that between 1973 and 1984, the incidence of this happening increased. And the reason why we were seeing more of these cases was primarily because of the HIV and AIDS patients starting to be diagnosed with this type of cancer. It's currently stable. The incidence, we're not seeing that it's increasing. It might have a slight decrease, especially with the use of antiretroviral medications. We're seeing that the cancer does not happen as frequently as before. And the median age of diagnosis is about 65. So anywhere from 60 to 70 is when we usually most commonly diagnose these patients. But again, in patients with HIV and AIDS, we can diagnose them at a younger age. And the incidence increases also with age. So older patients can also be diagnosed with CNS lymphoma. So like I said, the histology, once we know that this is CNS lymphoma, the histology is 90% of the cases diffuse large B-cell lymphoma. This is the type of cell that composes the cancer itself. The others are just 10%, and it can be low-grade lymphomas, Burkitt lymphomas, T-cell lymphomas, and very, very rarely we see Hodgkin's lymphoma. Okay? So back to this chart, we're talking about the diffuse large B-cell lymphoma or CNS, but any of the others can also form in the central nervous system as primary cancers. So the pathophysiology of this is very poorly understood. there's not too many studies because of the incidence being so low, and the tissue samples that we can collect during the patient's lifetime are just small tissue samples. We cannot do a lot of molecular or genetic studies on the pathophysiology of how this arises. There are some theories that talk about why this happens, but they're not very strong. The evidence is not very strong to support them. So one theory says that maybe normal abnormal lymphocytes that are trafficking the central nervous system suddenly become abnormal, and that's why they stay there, and that's why the central nervous system is affected and not anywhere else where we usually would see them. That's unlikely, but that's one of the theories. Now, systemically rotating or trafficking lymphocytes become abnormal, but for some reason that is also very poorly understood, have some neurotropism and go to the central nervous system and start there forming the tumor itself. So maybe a cancer that did start systemically, but for some form of endothelins or some form of adhesion molecules that have a specific neurotropism, go there, stay there, and create the masses and the tumors that we see. Another theory is that maybe it did start systemically, but we have a patient with a good immune system that is clearing the cancer cells in the whole body, but not in the CNS, because it's a system that's immunoprivileged or has a different type of immune system reactions, what they call immunological aberrant site. Okay? And almost all cells have this IGHV, the heavy gene for the immunoglobulins is altered. It happens in about 70 to 80% of these patients. So we think that this might play a role in the pathophysiology, the pathogenesis of why this happens. These somatic mutations are very, very common in them. And this is something that's different from the patients with systemic cancer. They do have the same mutations, but not as frequently as those with primary CNS lymphoma. So we might think this specific and might play a role in why it stays in the nervous system and not go anywhere else. And the fact that this happens can also suggest that there's some component of antigen activation. So something triggers these mutations and causes the cancer. That antigen might be an infection of some sort. Okay. Other things that we know about the pathophysiology is that it probably arises from a late terminal germinal center or a post-terminal center. And so not the early centers, the early phases of the lymphocyte proliferation, but the later phases. And they found three molecular subtypes. The one that's the germinal B, germinal center B cells, which has a more favorable prognosis. The ones that are activated, which has a poor prognosis. And the, what they call the type 3 cells, which is very poorly understood. And other thing that we found on these patients, and we can find on these patients, is overexpression between the GB cells, the GCB cells, so the germinal center B cells that are activated, but also an overlap with the ABC markers, the activated B cell markers. And we can see that these patients express a molecule called BCL6, which is now considered to be a prognostic factor. If you have it, it's a better prognostic marker, as well as MUM1, MUM1, which are both of them ABC markers. Okay. When they try to do transitional expression of this cells and try to see exactly what proteins they were making, they compared them to normal brain. This is a study that was published about 3 years ago. And what we can see here is that they compared three samples of normal brain tissue, 23 primary CNS lymphoma patients, and 9 patients with lymph node lymphoma. So systemical illness versus the primary central nervous system. And they saw that there was a very specific pattern. You see here, everything on red is upregulation of a gene expression. Downregulation is in green. And similar to the median or the normal brain tissue is in black. So it's kind of difficult, but you can actually see that this section right here up to this point, the patients with primary care, central nervous system lymphoma were overexpressing these types of molecules, including MYC,
the fast, kept a bigger transitional factors as well. And so why this happens and how this plays a role in the pathophysiology, again, is not very well known. But they are at least now finding that there's some very particular expression factors or signatures to these patients with primary CNS lymphoma compared to those with the systemic form of lymphoma, and of course, patients with normal brain tissue. Now, there's a component of patients with EBV positive lymphoproliferative disorders. And when we speak, the guidelines now say, the classification now state that patients who have primary CNS lymphoma have to be immunocompetent. If you're talking about an HIV patient, an AIDS patient that has lymphoma, then you're related with EBV because 90% of those patients will have positive titers in their CNS on the CSF analysis. But still, we see some immunocompetent patients who express the EBV genes, and so we think that this might play a role. Especially that happens on the immunosuppressed patient, like I said, and the elderly patients. And the pathophysiology and the pathology we see on these patients ranges anywhere from lymphoplasmacytic proliferation, so not gen malignancy, to a full-blown lymphoma. And this happens in external locations or immunoprivileged locations like the CNS, and that's why we see patients with HIV and EBV infections having CNS lymphoma. Like I said, it's about 90% of those patients that have positive titers, and when you have this on a patient with HIV, it's one of the three tumors or cancers that define AIDS. So like the infections, we have also tumors that define AIDS patients. CNS lymphoma, primary CNS lymphoma, is one of them. So they studied also those patients, the ones we're focusing today, which are the immunocompetent patients, and studied the EBV titers and how they work with them. They had 134 cases of primary CNS lymphoma. Only 16 of those patients were EBV positive, and out of those 16 who were EBV positive, only 5 of them had no history of immunosuppression. So they could only study those 5 patients who had primary CNS lymphoma, EBV positive, and no history of immunosuppression. Okay, and this is what they looked at. They figured the phenotype, the histologic features first, the phenotype, the type of cell of origin. The EBV status had to be positive, of course. The MICU and IGH also rearrangements. And you can see that they share a lot of the same morphologic features when you're looking at the slides in the microscope, but also the molecular signatures are very similar. So it does happen on patients who are immunocompetent, but it's a very small percentage, and we usually have to test for any patient who we're suspecting primary CNS lymphoma for EBV titers, usually in the CSF. Okay, so this is what they looked at. So what their conclusions from this study were is that it usually happens to older patients. We really don't know what causes this or how it provokes the CNS lymphoma, but we know that it happens more in older patients, that these patients have a primary immune response that is decreased, and that we can tell from underexpression of CD95 cells, and also they have clonal expansion of CD8 EBV positive cells that are dysfunctional, might disrupt some oncogenes, promote oncogene expression, or suppress the genes deregulation, and cause a cancer to occur. Now, if we talk about the clinical presentation of these patients. Patients with systemic lymphoma usually have these symptoms, meaning weight loss, fevers, night chills, things like that are very common for other types of cancer. But on patients who have primary CNS lymphoma, we see that that's not the case. Neurological symptoms are far more common. So depending on the location of where the tumor is, the patients usually have focal neurological deficits, and that happens in about 70% of the patients. Okay? We have neuropsychiatric symptoms, including personality changes, depression, mood disorders in 43% of those patients. We have signs of intracranial pressure, problems with visual acuity, headaches on 33% of the patients.
Seizures are not very common, but they do happen in about 14% of the patients. And we'll talk about how it's much more frequently those patients who are HIV patients and have the EBV titer present that have seizures. And some ocular symptoms when we have vitreoretinal lymphoma, and they usually complain about floaters, visual acuity deficits, and sometimes even red painful eyes. So like I said, these are patients who are more likely to have mental status changes, patients with AIDS and seizures compared to the immunocompetent patients. About 53% will have mental status changes compared to only 35% of those patients who are immunocompetent, and about 27% will have seizures versus 11 to 14% of those who are immunocompetent. So I said the location of the masses usually dictate the presentation of the focal neurological deficits. So when we talk about the location of where these masses are, mostly they're located supratentorial. And most of the times in immunocompetent patients, it's a single mass that's presented initially. So in the hemispheres, we see about 38% of those masses, which is the more common presentation. Then we see the thalamus and the basal ganglia masses that are following the hemispheres. The corpus callosum is a very common site of presentation, or at least expansion, extension of the tumor once it's progressed. The cerebellum, about 9% is affected. Like I said, most of the cases, about 65% of the cases, are solitary masses that are present, but we see about 35% of the cases have multifocal presentation. And again, I can't stress this enough, that those are mostly the patients who have immunosuppression. 20% of those patients who present with primary CNS lymphoma will also have ocular involvement. So these are patients who have lymphoma elsewhere, maybe the hemispheres, but also have ocular involvement. So solitary ocular involvement is very rare. It can happen, and the vitreoretinal lymphoma only happens about 1% of all primary CNS lymphomas. So it's very rare, but it can happen. Like I said, they complain of those symptoms, bloaters, visual acuity problems. Primary leptomeningeal CNS lymphoma is very rare. And when we do have those symptoms, and when we find a biopsy that's positive for lymphoma exclusively in the leptomeningeal tissues, then we should look for a primary cancer elsewhere, a primary lymphoma in the system. Get a PET scan, CT scan of the chest, abdomen, and pelvis. So what's the clinical initial evaluation? The evaluation of these patients is threefold. We have to have clinical, laboratory, and imaging evaluation of these patients. And the clinical is the first one we take care of course, and we have to do a complete medical exam. We have to ask our ophthalmology, neuro-ophthalmology, colleagues to see these patients and evaluate both sides with sleep gland examination for signs of involvement. We have to record the prognostic factors, and we'll talk a little bit about what those are, but their age is one of the more important, and the performance status. And of course, we send them to the neuropsych evaluation for cognitive function, because this will impact the way we treat these patients. When we talk about the lab evaluation of these patients, we have to make sure they're not HIV positive. We check the LDH, which is usually elevated in patients with primary CNS lymphoma. We check the creatinine clearance mostly for the purpose of treatment planning. And of course, we send a sample for CSF analysis. And on this sample, we'll send for cytology, flow cytometry, and the IgHPCR, which is the heavy chain. And I'll talk a little bit more about what we usually find on the CSF and how valuable the CSF usually is. Regarding the imaging, the best modality is MRI with contrast, and we'll talk also a little bit about what we find usually on MRIs of the brain with contrast on patients with CNS lymphoma. We also check for CT, chest, abdomen, and pelvis, like I said before, just to make sure that the primary is not in the cyst, anywhere else in the body, and this is just a metastatic disease. A bone marrow biopsy is usually reserved for the patients who have some suspicion of primary being elsewhere. And testicular ultrasound, especially in the elderly patients, since it's also an immune privileged site where CNS can where lymphoma can develop and can metastasize. So the CSF that we sent is very important, but it's very difficult as well to get the samples right at the first time to get the cells. It's about 50% of the patients will show, if they have primary CSF lymphoma, only about 50% of the patients will actually have the cells in the CSF on the first lumbar puncture. And it increases about to 90% if we repeatedly tap, especially if the taps are large volume taps. Other findings that we see on the CSF analysis is that the white blood cells are increased, about 7 cells per field in about 54% of the patients. Protein is usually increased, but not too high, maybe 69, the median that they found, and that occurs in about 67% of the patients. And the glucose is usually low, about 38, or that was the median that this study showed in about 10% of the patients. And like I said, the cytology, although if you have it, it's very specific, the sensitivity is very low, with only about 26 to 31% of those patients being positive or showing signs of malignant cells in the CSF. Now, in the gut population of patients with AIDS, it's even lower. 23% only of those patients will show malignant cells in the CSF, so the yield of the lumbar puncture is lower, but still, we have to take care of that and do a lumbar puncture in these patients to rule out other diagnoses. Because we'll see on the imaging, primary CNS lymphoma in patients with AIDS also mimics many multiple infections. And like I said before, about 90 to 80% of these patients will have EBV DNA, so we send for a PCR on the CSF. And we have to rule out toxoplasmosis, HIV encephalopathy, or a cryptocarcinoma, because the imaging is very similar to this. Now, when we send the samples for histology, the ultimate diagnosis of primary CNS lymphoma is made by histology, and a stereotactical biopsy from the neurosurgeons is what we usually prefer, not an excisional biopsy like with other brain tumors. And when we send these biopsies, what we see is usually a B cell proliferation. Usually it's angiocentric. So on image A, you can see the very big expansion of this mass here with some subependymal invasion and also invasion of the lateral ventricle even here. But this single mass is what is representing the CNS lymphoma. And on this slide here, what we can see is two vessels or even three vessels, one here, and a lot of lymphocytes are surrounding them. So we see this angiotropism in the central nervous system very, very frequently with CNS lymphoma. And not only that, but it's also angiodestructive. So it not only surrounds the vessels, but it also invades them and destroys them. As I said before, MYC overexpression is a very common pathophysiological finding, so we test for that. And as you can see here, there's a good percentage of these cells, most of these cells who are lighting up in brown are MYC positive cells.
Carlos,
yes, sir.
It seemed like that was a little venule that in the middle on that top right top
here.
Right.
Probably.
Yeah, look, the blood vessel looks more like a vein than an artery. So is there a tropism for veins as opposed to arteries, or does it make any difference?
Mostly arteries. Okay. And maybe this is, I'm not sure if it was the way they cut the slide or because of the angiodestructive nature of the tumor, maybe just crumbled and looks like that.
Yeah, there's another thin walled vessel with a bunch of red cells in it that might be a vein that does not seem to have a lymphocytic.
Yeah.
And the ACD and the EPI maps also show the same component of edema. We can also do MRS, which is the spectroscopy, and what we see here in this slide is a healthy volunteer and the normal curves that we should see on normal brain tissue, and we see what happens with lymphoma. So the choline peak rises significantly, the creatinine decreases, then N-acetyl aspartate is very commonly decreased compared to the patient, the healthy volunteer, and other things like the lactate also tends to increase. And this is not very specific for lymphoma, but it's very characteristic of it as well. One of the other evaluations that we have to do is rule out any ocular involvement, and we also tend to order the MRI of the orbits to find this type of lesions. Now, it's a very subtle lesion, but the arrow shows here involvement of the retina and this part right here. I'm not sure if it's clear how this is normal and this is not. And this might not even be normal. This might also be involved. But when we do the MRI, like I said before, we have to ask our ophthalmology colleagues to evaluate these patients because we've seen that MRI is inferior to the sleep lab examination. So it's a much easier, faster way to diagnose these patients. So the prognostic scoring and why it's important. It's important to prognosticate these patients because the treatment we're going to offer to these patients are usually very toxic. And so we find that some patients who have poor prognosis, it might not be the best idea to expose them to radiation, surgery, or other invasive procedures and treatments that are toxic if their survival is very poor. So there's two prognostic scales that are very commonly used. The IELSG, or International Extranodal Lymphoma Study Group, which evaluated about 300 patients, 378 patients in 23 centers, and they published this paper in 2003, giving us recommendations about how to prognosticate these patients. And this is what they asked us to look for: age, which is usually poor prognostic if it's over 60, the performance status, with an ECOG of more than one, which means a patient, more than one is a patient that can walk and do some activities of daily living, but usually cannot work. Elevated LDH, elevated CSF protein levels, and involvement of deeper regions of the brain. So these are the five categories we searched for, and those are the poor prognostic factors. And they gave us three risk groups, and we can see on the Kaplan-Meier curve below how different they are on the way that the disease course will be. The other score is the Sloan Kettering Memorial Cancer Center Prognosis Model, which was published in 2002. And this is a far much simpler scoring process because it only takes into account two criteria, the age and the KPF, or the performance status. And they also have three groups, and those are the curves for each of those groups. Age 50 or less have, of course, better prognosis. Age 50 or more with poor or not poor performance status have different prognosis as well. So once we've scored the patients, we go into the treatment. And the way we treat these patients is usually with methotrexate as the cornerstone of treatment. And this is high-dose IV methotrexate. And we'll talk a little bit about why that is. Now, if we use methotrexate by itself, and there have been studies that have looked into this, we see that there's a German group and also an American group that have looked into this in 2002 and 2003 respectively. And they saw that it decreases the toxicity as compared to other multi-drug chemotherapy protocols and radiation protocols. But it only has a progression-free survival of about 12 to 13 months. So it's very poor. So what about methotrexate and radiation, which is what we usually see in most of the centers? So they looked at that. This is a big study, and that looked into combining both of them. And what they found is that it increases the progression-free survival to 14 months, so it doubles the progression-free survival rate, but also causes a lot of toxicity. And there's many, many articles that I found about neurotoxicity. This one specifically looked into cognitive and performance status of patients who had received radiation. In 50 patients who were in remission, they found, they tested for three things: neuropsych evaluation, quality of life, and the extent of the white matter disease on MRI. And this is just some of the results they have. You can see on the gray, those patients who received whole brain radiation and methotrexate, and on black, those patients who only received the methotrexate. And you can see the big difference of patients who have attention problems, motor skill, and executive problems, and they've tested more things, but you can see the difference on how much better they did without the radiation. And so what other options we have for, if we need to use radiation, the options we have are, for example, using the regular doses of radiation at the regular fractions, which is 45 grays in 25 fractions, so that's a bigger dose in fewer doses or episodes, we call it fractions. And we can also try hyperfractionated dosing with lower fractions, lower doses but higher number of fractions, so 36 gray on 30 fractions. And they studied this on 82 patients, and what they found was that the time to grade 5 neurotoxicity, which is severe neurotoxicity, was decreased if you do the hyperfractionated, but it still occurred. And the same thing goes for the progression-free survival, which was not much better with hyperfractionated versus the full doses at the regular doses. So there's been a lot of controversy regarding this, and there's this paper, this is an editorial actually, on flying solo with chemotherapy without radiation. And what they found was that even a single dose of radiation therapy can cause cognitive decline in these patients. So even one single dose of full brain radiation causes hypocampal neurogenesis to be affected and therefore affect the prognosis and affect their quality of life. I'm going to talk about the CALBG trial, which is the more recent trial that was exactly published about a year ago in September of last year. And they showed that no difference was made between patients who did have radiation and not have radiation. And it eliminated the risk of neurotoxicity significantly. What about the surgical treatment of CNS lymphoma? So historically, surgical treatment of lymphoma in the CNS has never been recommended. But there's a few papers, and I found this one, who is challenging that paradigm, as their title says. And they saw that there's some difference between patients who did have resection and not have resection. And what they had was, they had 67 patients. 70% of those had subtotal resection, and the rest had either gross resection or biopsy. And what they found was that the patients with complete resection, and this is just one study, not a large population, but they found that they do a little bit better if they're a single mass present, and if it's not on a critical area that can be resected, of course. And those are the p-values for those lines. You can see complete resection versus partial resection versus just the typical biopsy we get, which is not an excisional biopsy. There's another paper talking about the same thing, and what they're concluding is, in the absence of high quality data, which we don't have, they conclude that patients with primary CNS lymphoma are probably not harmed by judicious resection. But this is very, this is not very well-funded material or information, and we usually don't even offer these patients a surgical approach because the relapse is...
So this would be a second surgery after an initial biopsy to prove it. Is that correct?
The biopsy is just a stereotactical biopsy, right. So it's just a very small amount of tissue. So you prove that diagnosis, and you resect the tissue, or you don't. That's what they were looking at on the previous study.
Did the authors try to quantify how many patients do they think would be candidates for...
No,
because the kind of sites lymphoma usually affects to find a patient who would not have any post-surgical FSHS.
Right. No, they didn't. But they, at the end, when they started talking about their conclusions, they talk about the deficiencies of their own study. But they didn't mention that. So, on the Blood Journal, which is one of the best journals for hematology and oncology, they published a paper, and they have a series of papers called How I Treat, and they published a paper on how I treat CNS lymphomas, and this is by the San Francisco group. And what they do is they have this algorithm, and I try to simplify it as much as possible and break it into steps so that we can digest it easier. So the first step would be to define the histology. Now, most cases, like I said, will be the diffuse large B-cell lymphomas. Then we could have the rare form of lymphomas, including Burkitt's and indolent type of lymphomas. So if we have a diffuse large B-cell lymphoma patient, what we do on the second step is determine their prognostic factors. So age, comorbidity, and the rest of the prognostic factors that we can find. So let's say we have a young and fit patient. What we would offer them is high dose according to how they treat these patients. High dose methotrexate and cytarabine, or RRC. And what they found then is that you assess the response of this patient, which is the third step. And if they have anything else other than progression of the disease, so complete response, partial response, or no change, what you can offer them is individualized treatment. Talk to the patient and decide whether you're going to go for full radiation or high-dose chemotherapy and stem cell transplant. If there's disease progression, what you can offer them is whole brain radiation at high doses. Remember, this is the young and the fit patients. So on patients who have, again, diffuse large B-cell lymphoma, but are not young, elderly patients, you can offer them high-dose methotrexate. This is what they did by itself, no radiation therapy. And you assess the response, and what you see is if they have complete response, you once again individualize the treatment, and you can tell them we can watch and wait, or we can go ahead and do the whole brain radiation, depending on how they're doing. If they only had partial or stable response, then you offer them the whole brain radiation. If they have disease progression, then you go for whole brain radiation, again, at a high dose. And this is the not so young, but fit patients. What about the patients who have, again, diffuse large B-cell lymphoma but are unfit for chemotherapy? So that's contraindicated, and you go to steroids and whole brain radiation if they are okay with that option. Okay? Now, the rare forms, you can use the systemic form of chemotherapy, which is R-CHOP, rituximab, cyclophosphamide, hydroxyrobicin, or adriamycin, and prednisone, of course. And you can offer them hydroxymethotrexate plus or minus cytarabine. And the patients with indolent lymphoma, just local treatment. The definition of response, I was talking about how you have patients with complete response, partial response, and disease progression. And in 2005, they published this paper to try to define this, what each of these mean. And I won't go through them in detail, but what you look for is brain imaging, doses of steroids, if they've had any eye examination, and CSF cytology. And based on this criteria, you determine whether the patient had partial, complete, or disease progression. So what the future is, again, this is a very recent paper, and what they're trying to do is to do a two-step approach for the treatment of primary CNS lymphoma. And their objectives were to measure the progression-free survival, the rate of complete response, and to try to determine if there were any molecular markers that could help us with the prognostication. And what they did was induction chemotherapy with consolidation chemotherapy using high-dose methotrexate, folate for prevention of the toxicity from high-dose methotrexate. They use rituxan on a weekly basis, and temozolomide or Temodar on the odd cycles, and that's for 14 cycles. After you finish those cycles, you go for a consolidation therapy, and that's only 4 days of etoposide and RLC. And what they found was those patients improved significantly compared to the there's no statistical significance, but there's a trend for improvement compared to those patients who only undergo high-dose methotrexate with radiation therapy in the progression-free survival, and this is by age groups. They did the same thing for performance status, and those patients with better performance status scores, of course, tend to do much better. And this almost reached some statistical significance. They tried progression-free survival, but the performance status using the IELS G-score, and they used the three groups. Remember that the ELGS G-scoring has three different groups. The ones who have better prognostic are, of course, those who have better performance status. Again, no significant statistical significance there, but they tend to do much better. Now, it's very important that they saw this, that whether you wait to start treatment by doing something else, like trying steroids or delaying the biopsy, delaying the diagnosis by more than 31 days, significantly adversely causes problems to the patient by decreasing the progression-free survival. Does this make sense? So when we compare it to that first study we talked about with patients receiving high-dose methotrexate by itself with radiation therapy versus this new study using the consolidation therapy as well with rituximab and temozolomide and the relatively newer medications, we see that there's some benefit added to this regimen. But of course, you have to be careful to the patients that do not have a good prognosis. So other treatments, there's a lot of studies going on right now about possibly using rituximab by itself. It's a large molecule. It has a little bit of trouble getting into the CNS, but it's a possibility, and it's been shown to be effective in some cases. They're usually not using it by itself, but in combination with other chemotherapeutic agents, like I said, methotrexate has to be the cornerstone. When they saw intrathecal chemotherapy, there are very few studies. There's only two studies that are larger, and they're retrospective studies, and then there's two other studies that are single-arm studies that show very poor information about whether to use intrathecal chemotherapy or not. So very low evidence and high incidence of complications and infections, and so we tend not to use the intrathecal chemotherapy for these patients. Now, the autologous stem cell transplant is an option that we talked about before, and there's a meta-analysis from these papers here, and the second column actually talks about the number of patients on each study. And most of these studies, what I found is that our first line, they tried the high-dose chemotherapy with the stem cells transplant as first-line treatment for these patients, and the outcome was pretty good, anywhere from 2 years up to 5 years of survival. But again, high-dose chemotherapy is reserved for those patients with very good performance status because it's very, very toxic. And there's a lot of studies also going on for salvage. I don't think I should go into a lot of detail, but they're using topotecan and other medications that are newer medications and are not approved, FDA approved for this diagnosis. But they're showing some improvement in patients who have relapsed, have failed all treatment, and are not using these medications. So this is basically the treatment of primary CNS lymphoma. And that's it. That's it. Depends on the size and the location of the mass, and if there's one mass or if there's multiple foci of the lesions. And of course, the bigger lesions, the deeper lesions, and the ones that cause more edema tend to have onset of symptoms earlier on rather than later. But it's highly variable. And patients with B2 retinal lymphoma usually tend to present sooner because they see the floater, so they go to the ophthalmologist and they see something that's abnormal. But the study only showed the difference, what they only saw was patients who were treated 31 days, so a month after diagnosis or as soon as the diagnosis was made, and they saw that the statistical significant difference on progression-free survival on those patients, for the better, of course, on the patient that were treated as soon as the diagnosis was made.
Well, a couple of things. You showed us the MRI of the globe. It's kind of hard to tell just by looking at that if the cancer is in the retina or actually in the vitreous. Mm-hmm. And if you look at the retina with direct ophthalmoscopy, you're not going to be able to tell anything about the vitreous. So that's another reason why it's important to get. Usually, if you look, if you see blurred, if you can't see the fundus, it's usually because there are cells in the vitreous.
The vitreous. Yes.
And the other is also, it could be in the choroid, too. Another thing that I just kind of like to pick Jeff's things, but you talked about the Memorial Sloan Kettering scale, and they use 50 as a cutoff. Okay. Well, look, if you told us it's between 60 and 70, so the peak is going to be around 65.
Right.
So if you use 50 as a cutoff, then you know, the majority of patients are going to fall into that group. So you're really shifting the curve and not really helping us very much. What we want to know is in that big group between 50 and 60, what's the age cutoff there that's important? But, you know, it's a picky point, but you know, people don't even think about these things. So these are smart people in Sloan Kettering.
I kind of
regarding
that study, but
Sloan
Kettering does attract all the pregnancies. Thinking it's probably not the same population as the community. They have to get a lot of younger kids because the annulus is there in Lauren Avery. So.
Well, but that means that maybe that scale is not applicable to the general.
Generally, yes, for patients, that's like the ECOG is